morning, everyone. And welcome to our service today. The Lord be with you. Our service begins with our opening hymn, O Worship the King, verses 1, 2, and 3. Shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilion in splendor and girded with praise. Sing of his might, oh, sing of his grace, whose robe is the light, whose canopy is space. His chariots of wrath, the deep thunder clouds form, and dark is his path on the wings of the storm. The earth with its store of wonders untold, almighty thy power hath founded of old. Established it fast by a changeless decree, and round it hath cast like a mantle the sea. Send out your light and your truth, that they may lead me and bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling. The Lord be with you. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Amen. Lord, open our lips. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Hallelujah. Let us say together the Venite. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the caverns of the earth, and the heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us bow down and bend the knee and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would hearken to his voice. Please be seated.
psalm today is Psalm 22, verses 23 through 31. Please read them responsively, or let's read in unison. Thank you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you offspring of Jacob, glorify him. Stand in awe of him, all of you offspring of Israel, for he did not despise or abhor the affliction of the afflicted. He did not hide his face from me, but heard when I cried to him. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will pay before those who fear him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all of the families of the nations shall worship him before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. To him indeed shall all who sleep in the earth bow down. Before him shall bow all who go down to the dust, and I shall live for him. Posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord and proclaim his deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying that he has done it. Our reading today is the book, first book of Samuel, chapter 9, verses 1 through 3. There was a man of Benjamin whose name was Kish, son of Abiel, son of Zerah, son of Bechorath, son of Aphiah, a Benjamite, a man of wealth. He had a son whose name was Saul, a handsome young man. There is not a man among the people of Israel more handsome than he. He stood head and shoulders above everyone else. Now the donkeys of Kish, Saul's father, had strayed. So Kish said to his son Saul, take one of the boys with you. Go and look for the donkeys. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God. Together, glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Our second reading today is 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 8 through 13. Already you have all you want. Already you have become rich. Quite apart from us, you have become kings. Indeed, I wish that you had become kings so that you might be the kings with you. For I think that God has exhibited us apostles as last of all, as though sentenced to death because we have become a spectacle to the world, to angels, and to mortals. We are fools for the sake of Christ, but you are wise in Christ. We are weak, but you are strong. You are held in honor, and we in disrepute. To the present hour, we are hungry and thirsty. We are poorly clothed and beaten and homeless, and we grow weary from the work of our own hands. When reviled, we blessed. When persecuted, we endure. When slandered, we speak kindly. We have become like the rubbish of the world, the dregs of all things to this very day. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God. The Canticle, the first song of Isaiah. We will read responsively to the whole verse. Surely it is God who saves me. I will trust in him and not be afraid. Therefore, you shall draw water with rejoicing from the springs of salvation. Make his deeds known among the peoples. See that they remember that his name is exalted. Cry aloud, inhabitants of Zion. Ring out your joy, for the Great One in the midst of you is the Holy One of Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. The third reading is from the Gospel according to Luke. As they were listening to this, Jesus went on to tell a parable, because he was near Jerusalem, and because they supposed that the kingdom of God was to appear immediately. So he said, a nobleman went to a distant country to get royal power for himself and then return. He summoned 10 of his slaves and gave them 10 pounds and said to them, do business with these until I come back. But the citizens of his country hated him and sent a delegation after him saying, we do not want this man to rule over us. When he returned, having received royal power, he ordered these slaves to whom he had given the money to be summoned so that he might find out what they had gained by trading. The first came forward and said, Lord, your pound has made 10 more pounds. He said to him, well done, good slave. Because you have been trustworthy in a very small thing, take charge of 10 cities. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
In the name of the one holy and living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. When you're someone who spends most of their days studying the Bible academically and you're asked to preach, particularly when one of the lessons for that day comes from your academic focus, there's always a risk that you're going to deliver a paper rather than a sermon. I assure you that will not be the case this morning. However, at the risk of starting a lecture series, today's lesson from 1 Corinthians needs a bit of background. The first thing you learn when studying the letters of Paul is that they were not intended to be scripture. They were letters to specific people in specific places at specific times about specific things. In this case, Paul was writing in the mid-50s of the Common Era to a church that was in an absolute state. They had split into factions over everything from which apostle was their favorite to who was more spiritual than whom, to questions of economic class hierarchy around the communion table, to concerns over how much they could interact with the surrounding religious culture and still remain faithful to Christ. These squabbles over seemingly minor theological points were ripping the church apart, and Paul's purpose in writing this letter was to make sure that didn't happen. But what he didn't do was call for a cheap unity. For some of these questions, like which apostle was best, Paul told everyone to take a seat and think about their lives. And that's where today's passage comes from. Paul's language is broadly sarcastic. Why are you bickering when you already have everything, he said, and the people you're bickering over have nothing. For other questions, though, Paul chose sides. When better off people were holding their own meals before the communion meal, Paul didn't look for a compromise. He told the better off people to cut it out. When people were arguing over whether meat offered to idols was fit for Christ followers to eat, he gave them a definitive answer. Yes, but under certain circumstances. And when matters of human sexuality were raised, he certainly gave his opinion at that time, at that place, to those people. But in no case did he punt the question with some appeal to his followers to agree to disagree. But for decades, That's precisely what the Anglican Communion would have its provinces, of which the Episcopal Church is one, do on matters of human sexuality. If you're new to Anglicanism or the Episcopal Church, here's 45 seconds on the Anglican Communion. It is what happened when England colonized half the planet and established its church everywhere it went. In many places, that church stuck, and because we all worship in the same way, we've stuck together in this community for the last 150 years. The Archbishop of Canterbury is recognized as the first among equals within the community of bishops, but he's not our pope. His opinion carries a lot of weight throughout the communion, but outside of the Church of England, he has no real authority. 10 minutes from now, that will become very, very clear. That worship in the same way bit is really important in Anglicanism. We truly believe that how we pray is how we believe. So the way we worship not only binds us together as Anglicans, but it is directly related to our theology. If our theology isn't at least similar enough that we can all worship together, our communion falls apart. And if some Anglican's theology states that in no way, shape, or form should people like me be allowed investments like these in pulpits like this because of Paul's opinions on human sexuality, and other Anglican's theology states that when God made everyone in God's own image, everyone is precisely what was meant, we have a hard time worshiping together. And with all of that disunity, what's an Archbishop of Canterbury supposed to do? Well, so far, the answer to that has been vacillating between nothing at all and make matters worse, all in an attempt to preserve unity. He's really not our pope. In 1998, the Lambeth Conference, which is a periodic conference of every bishop throughout the communion, published a report which had a section on human sexuality. This section defined marriage as a covenant between a man and a woman, and also included some harsh language regarding scripture and homosexuality. However, in between passages saying people like me can't get married or ordained, and that our expressions of love are inherently sinful and run contrary to the word of God, it also included a clause reminding us that we are loved by God and that all baptized, believing, and faithful persons, regardless of sexual orientation, are full members of the body of Christ. Now this, as you can well imagine, set off a firestorm of controversy. In the Episcopal Church, we were already 2 years past a heresy trial whose verdict said that our church has no doctrine prohibiting the ordination of homosexuals. Some priests had been blessing marriages between two people of the same gender for years. The fight, and it was a fight, was far from over, but the sides had been drawn, and in the Episcopal Church, it was not new territory. And as similar progress was being made toward full inclusion of people whose love is more expansive than the heterosexual binary in other provinces, such as Canada, Scotland, New Zealand, and Southern Africa, what this section of the 1998 report did was draw lines communion-wide. And for the last 24 years, spanning the tenure of two archbishops, the See of Canterbury has been attempting to tie those lines together by not fully opposing affirming provinces and not fully supporting their more conservative opponents. Now, doing nothing at all and pretending the controversy doesn't exist would have been more helpful. And as the upcoming Lambeth Conference was forming, it looks like that was going to be the case. And before COVID, remember COVID? Before COVID, as the 2020 conference was being planned, Archbishop of Canterbury, Justin Welby, announced that while gay and lesbian bishops would be welcomed at the conference, their spouses, unlike those of bishops in heterosexual relationships, would not be. Classic Canterbury, honestly. You're completely equal, and we love you, just not in a way that would make waves. And that's been about their brand since 1998. But after 2.5 years of pandemic, Welby announced that, even though he officially disinvited those spouses, the conference itself would focus on the things that unite us, like our looming climate catastrophe, and not on things that divide us. Then, last week, bishops who had registered for the conference received a 60-page document of items to be voted on as setting the collective position of global Anglicanism. Well, not really voted on, because Archbishop Welby didn't want to give the appearance of making policy while making de facto policy. Among these items, or calls, is one titled Human Dignity. In it are paragraphs about the ways imperialism, white supremacy, and capitalism, well, without really naming capitalism, but, you know, still, have harmed the world, and the ways in which global warming is going to exacerbate that. But then there's this, and I'm going to read this whole paragraph to give you its entire scope. Prejudice on the basis of gender or sexuality threatens human dignity. Given Anglican polity, and especially the autonomy of provinces, there is disagreement and a plurality of views on the relationship between human dignity and human sexuality. Yet we experience the safeguarding of dignity in deepening dialogue. It is the mind of the Anglican communion as a whole that same-gender marriage is not permissible. Just a second on that. That cannot be the mind of the communion as a whole, because literally they had gay and lesbian bishops whose spouses weren't in... Anyway, you get it. Lambeth Resolution 1.10 from 1998 states that the legitimizing or blessing of same-sex unions cannot be advised. It is the mind of the communion, again, to uphold faithfulness in marriage between a man and a woman in lifelong union. It is also the mind of the communion that all baptized, believing, and faithful persons, regardless of sexual orientation, are full members of the body of Christ and to be welcomed, cared for, and treated with respect. Again, we love you, but not in a way that would make waves. Beloved, Jesus made waves. That was his whole deal. The Word became flesh in order to make waves. And for those waves, he was crucified. And through those waves, he rose again. And with those waves, we spread the good news of liberation and salvation to the ends of the earth. In our catechism, we are told that God is love, and God is a love that makes waves. And as much as Anglicanism is a middle way, the love of God has never been a thing to be compromised. A middle way is not going along to get along. A middle way is looking for the best in each other. A middle way is understanding how we can live with each other, even though we understand some things differently. A middle way is both and, not neither nor. Which leaves LGBTQIA plus Anglicans and those who affirm and support us with that age-old question, how do you live in communion with people who do not respect your full humanity? You don't. And that's the dangerous part. The middle way was intended to show high and low church Anglicans how not to kill each other over sacramental theology, not to bind queer Anglicans to a choice between their religious tradition and themselves. We don't want to think about it, but there comes a point where compromise is no longer possible, even among Anglicans. And the full acceptance of all of God's creation as intrinsically holy is that point. Paul's call in 1 Corinthians was one of unity, but that unity did not ask the Corinthian assembly to do away with the gospel. The gospel came first then, and it comes first now. Paul would no more have us sacrifice our Christianity on the altar of unity than he would allow the Corinthians to eat meat sacrificed to the gods in a way that demonstrated belief in them. Paul took sides. Jesus took sides, and so should we. And so should the See of Canterbury. Episcopalians have long been known as the frozen chosen, and not without merit. While our evangelical and charismatic siblings were loudly decrying the sins of the world, we were quietly conferring on whether the Eucharist should be celebrated once or twice a month. We didn't want to make waves. Talking about sin gets messy. Feelings get hurt. Schisms happen. And after we started to thaw out a bit, we had one of those schisms. In 2009, a group of Anglicans in the Episcopal Church hated gay people and weren't crazy about women enough to form a whole church over the idea. Officially, we mourn and lament schisms. But as someone who left Christianity as a whole in 2004 because of the Episcopal Church's lukewarm response to being chided over the consecration of a gay man as bishop, I think it was the best thing that could have happened to us. When I came back in 2015, the dust had settled, and I knew that I could slide into a pew and most likely not be abused by the theology in the pulpit. And that's important. Christianity should not be easy, and it might not be painless. Following Jesus can take everything from you, but it should never be abusive. We venerate people who died for their faith, but they weren't abused by it. Next week, the bishops who attend the voting sessions on the various calls will be able to vote either, quote, "This call speaks for me, I add my voice to it and commit myself to take the action I can to implement it," or, "This call requires further discernment, I commit my voice to the ongoing process." In other words, yes, or yes, but let's wordsmith a little. Many bishops from provinces and dioceses that affirm the holiness of all of God's creation have lamented the lack of a no vote. Others, like the Right Reverend Jennifer Reddle, Bishop of Arizona, notes that she will come home to her diocese having voted against human dignity. And the Bishop of Los Angeles, the Right Reverend John Harvey Taylor, sees what the bottom line will look like to those not versed in Anglican polity. Lambeth doesn't legislate or set policy, he says, but that won't matter to a global audience that is likely to read that a majority of Anglican bishops refused to affirm the dignity of every human being. I invited a friend to church at St. George's this morning. They came to the 8 a.m. Mass with me, and they're sticking around for the 10 a.m. Their only familiarity with Christianity is what they've heard through popular culture. But they believed me when I said I had found a better way, and when I showed them the trans pride flag we have in our narthex, they gasped at the way it flowed seamlessly into the rest of our sanctuary. Whenever anyone comes into one of our churches, I hope they feel that sense of wonder at our liturgy. We pride ourselves as Anglicans in having common worship, and in that worship, a feeling of belonging should be something we hold in common. A feeling of true holiness, of oneness with each other and all of God's creation should be held in common. The understanding that when you walk into a church, you are safe, loved, and celebrated as a beloved child of God should be held in common. Because the way we pray is the way we believe. And I truly believe that if we don't risk everything, even our communion, to spread the good news of Jesus Christ for all people, our prayers ring hollow and our beliefs are useless. Anglicanism is too important to be used as an idol to itself. Please join me in praying that the bishops at Lambeth Palace this week come to understand this. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brigid. I thank you. The congregation thanks you for being here today. And now, those of you who are able to stand, please stand. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Save your people, Lord, and bless your inheritance. Day by day we bless you. Lord, keep us from all sin today. Lord, show us your love and mercy. In you, Lord, is our hope. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, the fountain of all wisdom, you know our necessities before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Have compassion on our weakness and mercifully give us those things which for our unworthiness we dare not, and for our blindness we cannot ask, through the worthiness of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord God, almighty and everlasting Father, you have brought us in safety to this new day. Preserve us with your mighty power, that we may not fall into sin, nor be overcome by adversity. And in all we do, direct us to the fulfilling of your purpose, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you, through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Prayers of the people.
In peace we pray to you, Lord God. For all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, and Carly, our bishop, and for all bishops, for Reverend Rose, our priest, and other ministers.
For all who serve God in his church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation.
For Ukraine, Ethiopia, and any other war-torn areas in the world.
For Don, Marianne, the Farrell family, Bob, Finland and Sweden, Vincent, Nancy, Saul and Susan, Mary, Allison, Janice. We pray for those who are traveling this week.
Any travelers?
Anyone traveling?
Oh, sorry, my own husband. Okay, let's pray for travelers.
O God, whose glory fills the whole creation, and whose presence we find wherever we go, preserve those who travel, in particular all these gathered here, and those who travel with them. Surround them with your loving care, protect them from every danger, and bring them in safety to their journey's end. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We pray
for the committee of the month, which is Property and Memorial Gardens Committee. We pray in this month of July, which is Disabilities Pride Month. Please add your own petition.
We thank God for all our members in our church, our family members.
Do we have any birthdays this coming week?
Ah.
Wednesday, okay.
That's Friday, okay. Any others?
Anybody on Zoom with a birthday? No?
All right, let's do the birthday prayer.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to all of you. Happy birthday to you.
And my gift was not to sing. Watch,
Watch over your children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts may your peace, which passes all understanding, abide all the days of their life. Through Jesus Christ, O Lord. Amen.
Do we have any anniversaries? Anybody on Zoom? All right, we'll pass. Okay. We exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all those who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Oscar Tate, who died on July 4th. Levere Dean, brother of Esther Johnson, who died on July 5th. Abosi, Chelsea Green's father. Winston Campbell, who died July 19th.
Don Reynolds.
Don Reynolds.
Oh, okay. May her soul Don rest Reynolds. In peace.
For all the people who have died in all the mass shootings that continue weekly in the United States. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Who put their trust in you. The peace of the Lord be always with you. God bless you.
Good morning, church. This is Vern. May the Spirit of the Lord be with you today and always. Glad to be with you.
Good morning, Vern. It's Allison and Elaine. Good morning to everyone. Blessings.
Thank you. Good morning to you too.
Hi, Kati.
Good morning.
Good morning. Hi, everyone.
Good morning, Kay. Love and blessings. How are you?
Good morning, Val. Peace to you. I got through.
Good morning.
Is that
this is Val. I ask you to pray for me as I go on Wednesday for two more procedures. Just for the doctors to find out exactly what's going on with me.
Keep you in our prayers.
Yeah, have our prayers.
We heard you, Val. We heard
you.
The church is praying for you.
Thank you.
The peace of the Lord.
I ask you to pray for Curtis and Dorissa as they just lost their wife and mother, Dawn, who died yesterday afternoon.
Thank you, Van. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The offer him. I feel like I'm in a hole. I feel like I'm in a hole. It's so low. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always there. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and he talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives. Salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. Rejoice, O Christian. I lift my voice and sing eternal hallelujah to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and he talks with me along his way. He lives,
Amen.
Showed up at Mar-a-Lago, taking that picture with Donald Trump.
I would just like to announce that we have two funerals this week. Mr. Winston Campbell, who died on the 4th, I think. No, it was not the 4th, on the 19th. Yes. On Tuesday at 11 a.m. And Mr. Oscar Tate, who died on the 4th. His funeral will be Friday morning at 11 a.m. I would like to draw your attention to a few of the upcoming events. The Prison Ministry Backpack Project, which goes through August 18, and the exciting update about the Boiler Fund. SAC will be providing dinners for the St. Paul's Men's Shelter on July 30. And our next date for the soup kitchen will be on the 1st of October. Madam, would you like to elaborate?
Morning, church.
Morning.
Hi, another event that we want to bring your attention to is we have our Design a Bag game night that is set for September 10th. Tickets are on sale. I do have some flyers on the back of the church. The information was also sent out in the email blast. So you can reach or contact me or Eva for tickets. In terms of the Boiler Fund, as it says in the bulletin, we are $17,000 away from paying off for the Boiler Fund. So you can donate through Banco and just label what the donation is for, or you can certainly continue to contribute via checks or cash if you would like so. We would really appreciate that. As Enid said, on October 1st is our next soup kitchen. And then also The fundraising committee has masks available for $10. All the other details of the schedule that's upcoming is in the bulletin. If you do have questions, I'm here. You can ask, or I think everyone knows my number or my email address. You can certainly reach out. Thank you.
Thank you. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting. Amen. Our closing hymn is O Worship the King, verses 4 and 5. Of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us and those we love this day and always. Amen. Thanks be to God. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. May you have a wonderful week. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor.
No. I'm a little nervous. Thank you.
Have a beautiful week. Blessings all.
Ms. Adi.
Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Stay cool.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Bye.
Take care. Get it over there too. Oh. Yeah. Mm-hmm. They had a good home. I'm glad they had that good attendance. Yes, Kay is there. Did you take us off?